Clerk will read the caption to a group of privileged resolutions. Clerk will read.
This first resolution is an invitation resolution. It's being read today for the first time, being referred to the Committee on Rules. A resolution by Representative Smith, 129th, committing Mr. Howard H. Bocalloway, inviting him to be recognized by this House of Representatives. Following resolutions are privileged resolutions being read for the first time today for adoption. Resolution by Representative Clark, the 98th, recognizes committing Chip Ness. Resolution by Representative Williams, 165th, on the life and memory of Dr. Lorenzo P. McNeil. Resolution by Representative Jordan, 77th, recognizes commending Mrs. Iris B. Jesse. Resolution by Representative Morris, 155th, recognizing the siege of Beirut on the occasion of its 30th anniversary, on the life and memory of its lost veterans. Resolution by Representative Holmes, 125th, recognizes commending Central Georgia Electric Membership Corporation, occasion of its 75th anniversary. Resolution by Representative Williams, 113th, recognizes commending Mr. Fred W. Greer Jr. on the occasion of his retirement. Resolution by Representative Dudgeon, 24th, recognizes commending 2011-2012 Georgia Tech women's basketball team. Resolution by Representative Harold, 106th, recognizes commending Mrs. Runelle Nell Brooks Foster on the occasion of her 106th birthday. Resolution by Representative Holmes, 120th, recognizes committing Piedmont Academy's football team 2011 GISA State AA Championship. Resolution by Representative Atwood, 179th, recognizes committing Golden Isles Aviation for being named the ConocoPhillips Aviation Fixed Base Operator of the Month. Resolution by Representative Holmes, 125th, commending the Jones County High School's 2012 Star Teacher. Resolution by Representative Holmes, 125th, commending Troy Chittis II, Jones County High School's 2012 Star Student. Resolution by Representative Jackson, 142nd, recognizes commending Mrs. Annie Burns Johnson on her 100th birthday. Resolution by Representative Holmes, 125th, recognizes commending students of Piedmont Academy's One Act Play on their 2011 Georgia Independent School Association AA State One Act Play Championship. A resolution by Representative Jaspers, the 12th, recognizes commending Mr. William Dillbeck and Mrs. Gail Dillbeck. Resolution by Representative Powell, 29th, recognizes commending Mr. John Henry Shambly. Resolution by Representative Scott, 2nd, honoring the life and memory of Mr. Alvin Leon Scott and for other purposes. Resolution by Representative Scott, 2nd, recognizes commending Mr. Joseph Joe Burton Johnson, Mrs. Ruby Elizabeth Johnson on the occasion of their 71st wedding anniversary. Resolution by Representative Mayo of the 91st, recognizes commending Mother Clara Georgia Sims on the occasion of her 100th birthday. A resolution by Representative Shaw, 176, honoring the life and memory of the Honorable Harry D. Dixon, Sr. Resolution by Representative Parsons, 42nd, recognizes commending Sprayberry High School for being one of the 2011 Georgia Schools of Excellence. Resolution by Representative Waits, the 60th, recognizes commending Forest Hills Academy. Resolution by Representative Baker, the 78th, recognizes commending Clayton County Family Care, Inc., occasion of its 60th anniversary. And resolution by Representative Stevens, 161st, honoring the life and memory Mr. Aspinwall Hodge Pat Reed. Resolution by Representative Purcell, 159th, recognizing commending Representative Amos Amerson. Resolution by Representative Rogers, the 10th, recognizing commending the Habersham Christian Learning Center, Incorporated. Resolution by Representative Rogers, 26th, recognizing commending Gainesville High School Academic Bowl Team, 2012 Academic Bowl State Championship. Resolution by Representative Williams, 113th, recognizes commending Mr. Steve Middlebrooks. Resolution by Representative Purcell, 159th, commending the Effingham County School System South Effingham High School's 2012 Star Student. Resolution by Representative Purcell, 159th, commending Mrs. Daphne Sherman, Effingham County School System South Effingham School's 2012 Star Teacher. Resolution by Representative Scott, 76, honoring the life and memory Mrs. Ardina Miles Beasley. Resolution by Representative Hamilton, 23rd, honoring the life and memory Mr. Everett Bennett. Resolution by Representative Hamilton, 23rd, honoring the life and memory Mr. James Goodman Baker. Resolution by Representative Kirby, 107, recognizing commending Grayson High School football team, 2011 Georgia High School Association Class 5A State Championships. And a resolution by Representative Davis, 109th, recognizes commending Mr. Shane Thompson on the occasion of Shane's Rib Shack's 10th anniversary through the privilege resolutions.
Is there objection to adopting the privilege resolutions? Chair hears none. The resolutions are adopted. All right, we're going back to the rules calendar. The chair has been advised before we came back after the lunch break that Representative Lenmore James is alert and stable. He's been moved into a room at, Emory Midtown. Is that where he is? They're going to keep him at least overnight for test and observation. So I'm going to ask the members of this House to please continue to keep Representative James and his family in your prayers. And as we learn additional information about his condition, I'll certainly let you know as I know, and I want to thank the minority leader for keeping me informed. We're back on the rules calendar, and we've got several measures we're going to take up this afternoon. I'm going to ask for your cooperation to make sure that we have order here on the floor of the House so that members who do want to hear the presentations from the well and the debate will have that opportunity. If for any reason you feel like you can extend that that courtesy, then I'm going to ask you to take leave of the chamber and go outside and do whatever it is that is more important to you. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 1176. House Bill 1176.
House Bill 1176 by Representative Golick of the 34th, a bill to be entitled Amendment Title 15, Title 16, relating to general provisions relative to courts, crimes, and offenses, respectively, so as an act provisions recommended by the 2011 Special Counsel on Criminal Justice Reform for Georgians, and enact other criminal justice reforms to amend Title 17, relating to criminal procedure, amend Code Section 1975 relating to reporting child abuse, expand mandatory reporting requirements, amend Title 35 relating to Georgia Crime Information Center, change provisions relating to inspecting, purging, modifying, and supplementing criminal records, amend Title 42 relating to penal institutions, provide for the use of evidence-based practices in supervising inmates, probationers, and parolees, to amend certain titles of the official code of Georgia annotated so as to conform to provisions and correct cross-references. The Special Joint Committee on Georgia Criminal Justice Reform recommends that this bill do pass by way of committee substitute. The bill is being read today for its third time.
The chair recognizes the co-chair of the Special Joint Committee on Criminal Justice Reform, Chairman Golick, to present the bill. Chairman Golick.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and ladies and gentlemen of the House. I come to you for your consideration to present House Bill 1176. This is the governor's proposed criminal justice reform package. Recall that last year we passed House Bill 265. House Bill 265 set up a criminal justice reform council that was charged over the balance of last year to look at our criminal justice system and to make a variety of recommendations to the General Assembly about what we could be doing better in all aspects of our criminal justice system. That council met over the balance of last year, many meetings, many committees, many subcommittees, and really did a tremendous job in laying out a very wide range of recommendations of what we could do to make our criminal justice reform system, criminal justice system, better. As a result of that, they went ahead and issued their report, and House Bill 1176 is the result of taking many of those recommendations and in consultation, of course, with our friends in the other body as part of a joint committee and in partnership with the administration of Governor Nathan Deal. This substitute has come forward for your consideration. I think the first question to ask is, and let me just make sure you're aware, in addition to the bill, you should have had a summary on your desk, either in your respective caucus's whip report or separately was passed out yesterday along with the bill. I'm not going to go through the bill section by section, fear not. What I will do, though, and I think what the proper course on this will be to go ahead and to lay out a vision of what changes were made, what we propose to do, and why. The why has to do very much with the fact that right now our prison system is swelling with nonviolent offenders. If you look at a list of the reasons for the 2010 admissions into our correction system, the five charges that are most prevalent in terms of prisoners who go into our system, half of them are nonviolent. They're usually theft or drug possession, and that really gave us a good idea of what we needed to be doing in terms of these recommendations. Here's what's really happening. What's really happening is that we have a segment of our population in the prison system that are drug addicts. I don't want to sugarcoat that in any way, shape, or form. These are individuals with substance abuse problems. And the way our drug statutes are structured is such that the user is subject to very harsh criminal penalties as per the current state of the law. But the difference is that in being prosecuted again and again, they go back into the system, serve a certain sentence, have no rehabilitation of their, no real rehabilitation capability at their disposal, and then what happens? They get released, and they go ahead and reoffend. And how do they reoffend? They probably reoffend by committing a theft crime, some sort of drug-related crime or some sort of theft-related crime, gaining money in order to feed drug habits. And what happens? They go back into the system, but this time for a longer sentence. So, and then upon the completion of that sentence, what happens? They go back out into the street, and then what do they do? They reoffend. And it ends up being this vicious cycle of counterproductivity, not just for the individual, of course, but for the system. Why? Because these nonviolent offenders go back, reoffend, go back into the system, and what are they really effectively doing? They're taking up bed space that we could otherwise use and should otherwise use for violent offenders. So what this bill purports to do is to take a new look and a new approach as to how we treat nonviolent offenders. And I want to make something just very, very clear for purposes of our debate going forward. And that's the fact that as we look at these crimes, they are focused really on drug possession and on theft crimes. They are not in any way touching drug sale or drug trafficking. And I think in the minds of the people that we represent, including in our own minds, that's a very great dividing line. I think there's a very clear idea of what we're talking about when we're talking about the drug user the abuser, the addict, versus someone who's engaging in a commercial enterprise, corrupting others in our society through the sale of drugs and the trafficking of drugs. What we focus on today really is drug possession and theft crimes. One of the biggest changes that we made, or we proposed to make in this substitute, is that right now, the way we prosecute drug crimes is we take an offender who has possession of a gram of whatever it may be, all the way up to 28 grams, and we lump them into the same category for sentencing purposes. There's a very big difference if you talk to prosecutors and defense lawyers and to law enforcement, and we talk to all of them. There's a very big difference between the offender who has 2 grams of whatever it may be versus the offender who has 27.5 grams. Those are two very different offenders, and as a result, the thought is that our sentencing laws ought to reflect those two different types of offenders. So we have proposed to go to a weight-based system. What does that mean? That means that rather than lumping in all of these offenders into one category, if they have a gram of something all the way up to 27.9 grams, what we purport to do is to have a weight-based system whereby we go ahead and treat these offenders, or the court system, judges and prosecutors, will treat these offenders according to how much of the drug that they have. And those are set out in the bill, 1 to 2 grams, 1 to 4 grams, 4 to 27 grams, et cetera. And what that will allow the court system to do is to treat offenders as they need to be treated in the system. What we also seek to do in this, and what we heard from our judges, and we listened to a lot of judges, and again, a lot of other people in the court system, is that the judges felt that they had their hands tied, and this goes back to the sentencing conversation we had a discussion of a moment ago. What we seek to do is to give judges more discretion to sentence as they see fit for a possession rather than being locked into a mandatory sentence that may, and that's the key word, that may not be needed. And then again, getting the individual into a vicious cycle of getting sentenced, remaining to have a problem, going back out on the street, reoffending, going back into the system, and having that vicious cycle of addiction just repeat itself. And from a fiscal standpoint, where does that leave the taxpayers? Well, as a practical matter, when these people come out and they go ahead and reoffend and then go back in, if they're in on their third or fourth conviction for, let's say, a year, then they're going to go back out, reoffend, go back into the system and serve maybe 1 to 2 years, and then maybe 2 to 3 years after that, we're supporting that individual to the tune of over $15,000 a year when we could go ahead again and use that bed space for a truly violent offender. So what this bill does is it separates those possession statutes into weight-based approaches for prosecution. How much is that going to cost? Well, we took the testimony of the GBI director, and we took testimony of our prosecutors as well. And there is an upfront cost for what this will do in terms of personnel for the crime lab and personnel for individual prosecutors' offices. Why? Because you're going to have a situation where if you have to weigh every substance for every charge, that is going to take time, it's going to take money. And so what we insisted upon in order to have this proposed law implement on a truly seamless basis is to go and incrementally implement this. And what I mean by that is part of this law will take effect as it relates to our drug prosecutions in 2013, and the rest of it will go into effect in 2014. That will allow time for the proper amount of hiring, training, and purchase of equipment, both on the part of the GBI and our respective DA's offices. As a practical matter, I think for the prosecutors, they're going to need an additional prosecutor in every office simply to handle drug prosecutions. To the administration's credit, and I thank Governor Deal for this, the administration understands that these changes do cost money, and we do have a commitment from the administration to go ahead and help fund this project, help fund this initiative, both in July of 13 and then again in 2014. The substances that we would begin with in July 2013 would be your Schedule 1 and Schedule 2. Those are usually cocaine and methamphetamine are the most infamous of those drugs within the Schedule 1, Schedule 2, and then we'd go ahead and implement Schedules 3, 4, and 5 in July of 2014. I want to talk to you for a minute about theft crimes. We have a variety of theft crimes: theft by taking, shoplifting, and a variety of others, a laundry list of others. And they have various thresholds that you have to meet in order to be considered a felony. They may be 300, they may be 500. If in a certain situation, if you're stealing or shoplifting above a certain level, that becomes a felony. If it's theft by taking, you steal something, theft by taking over a certain level, that becomes a felony. Those thresholds have been in effect since 1983. That's nearly, 30 years ago. And of course, the world has changed in 30 years. And so what we've noticed, and I mean, looking at the data, again, half of the people who are incarcerated, new admissions into the correction system in 2010, half of them were for drug possession and for theft-related crimes. What we've seen over time is that these individuals, as I said before, will go ahead and steal. Why are they stealing? To support a drug habit. Well, if they steal over on a certain crime over a threshold of 300 or 500, which is not very hard to get to, that becomes a felony. Once it's a felony, obviously that's a serious matter. If it becomes a first, if it becomes a second or third, then they're looking at jail time. These are, however, nonviolent offenders. What we attempted to do was to set a nearly uniform threshold on how we're going to treat these theft crimes. So we took that threshold and moved it up to 1,500 for nearly all of the theft-related crimes, but not all of them. 1,500 brings us into line with our neighboring states. Some are a little lower, some are a little higher. 1,500 is pretty much right in the middle. There is one exception, however, and that is with shoplifting. We heard from the Georgia Retail Association that there are, and it was a learning experience for many of us, there are very sophisticated organized crime, what's called organized retail crime syndicates in our state. And what they will do is they will send out whatever the individuals are called, we'll call them pawns in their scheme, to go to various retail locations and steal right up to the line. And these syndicates are very sophisticated. They know exactly where the felony line is, and they will send their accomplices out into the malls or wherever it may be and steal right up to that line. So in respect to them, with respect to our retail community at their request, and to demonstrate our sensitivity, that we understand that if we go ahead and set the threshold high, the thieves are going to go right up to that line. That's not going to help our businesses, small businesses and big businesses. And so with respect to that, we went ahead and set the threshold at 1,500 for almost all theft crimes, with the exception of shoplifting, which we kept at 500. Let me talk to you about burglary. What we did on burglary is we set burglary into 3 degrees. Right now, burglary is burglary. Meaning if you go ahead and commit a burglary at a certain type of structure, it's a burglary. If it's a non-dwelling or a dwelling or a commercial business. So the law really isn't distinguishing between someone breaking into your home, which of course is an indescribable personal violation if you've ever been burglarized or you know someone that's been burglarized, versus, let's say, a teenager breaking into someone's shed, stealing a shovel or a tennis racket or whatever it may be. Those are two very different crimes, I think. They're still burglary, but they're two different crimes, I think, in the minds of the public, and I think in our own minds as well. And the law needs to reflect the fact that the more serious conduct will bring a more serious consequence. So what we intend to do here under this substitute is to split burglary into 3 crimes. A non-dwelling is a third-degree burglary. A dwelling crime, where a burglary occurs with regard to a dwelling, is second-degree burglary. And then if there's a dwelling burglary that occurs and there's a weapon involved, or someone gets hurt, or other aggravating circumstances occur, that becomes a first-degree burglary, and that's got a minimum mandatory of 5 years. And I think what you see there is it's a recognition that burglaries are different, and the law needs to reflect that, and they need to reflect the circumstances of the actual crime itself, the facts of the crime. There are some other sections to our bill that were requested by various constituencies. Again, we met with the judges, we met with prosecutors, defense lawyers, law enforcement. Whoever wanted to talk to us, we talked to them, and we were all ears, and it was very much a learning experience for many of us, including me. I will tell you that there is a lot of movement, a lot of, I wouldn't say clamor, but a lot of desire to see us address the statute of limitations with regard to certain sex crimes involving a victim under the age of 16. And so in Part 4 of the bill, which is the criminal procedure part, under Section 4-2, We seek to remove the statute of limitations for certain sex crimes, rape, child molestation, incest, aggravated sodomy, cruelty to children, involving a victim under the age of 16. And this is where we begin to see the input of many of the members of this General Assembly. Representative Ben Harbin from Columbia County brought this to our attention. It was a good idea. We had some discussions amongst the court community, I'll call it, and decided to include, and we appreciate his input on that. In part five of the bill, we went ahead and addressed the issue of mandatory reporting of child abuse. Under our law right now, certain individuals in the community have to go ahead and report suspicion of child abuse. However, that list is really not broad enough, and certain news events of the past several months compelled us to examine our own statute and to see, is it broad enough? What we didn't want to do is to make it too broad, because you didn't want to have a situation where you had everyone and anyone's a mandatory reporter, because the reality of that is that individuals would ultimately be mistaken to be in situations, you'd have a lot of he said, she said situations with regard to child abuse, and the district attorney would be in a situation of potentially indicting innocent people. So we didn't want to do that, but we did want to go ahead and expand the list of people in a common sense manner who needed to go ahead and be required by law to report child abuse. And the section that you see there in section 5-1 is an amalgam of input, including language that was supplied by Representative Mary Margaret Oliver, Representative Abrams, Representative Randall, Representative Jacobs. In combination, I think we've got a good balanced product as it relates to mandatory reporting of child abuse. The other sections of this bill I'm going to personally hold on speaking about, because Representative Jay Neal, Chairman Jay Neal, the chairman of the State Institutions and Property Committee, is going to go ahead and discuss those. That has to do with record restrictions for individuals, and then what I call the Title 42 piece having to do with our correction system. That obviously is what Chairman Neal does in his capacity as chair, and I'm going to defer discussion on that to him during his time in the well. And before I conclude and certainly stand for any questions, I just wanted to go ahead and thank a few people. One being the Attorney General's office, and specifically Mary Beth Westmoreland, for that office's continued role as a tremendous resource to the General Assembly and to the committee and to me personally, and I'm personally grateful. And of course, our legislative counsel, Jill Travis, for her tireless work, sometimes over a few weekends with really nice weather, and I really appreciate her efforts in that regard. My committee lawyer, Matt Wasitoski, went ahead and did the summary that you have, and I think it's a pretty good summary that walks us through the various changes in English as opposed to some of the statutory language that we have to put in there in order to be legally correct, but can be very, very difficult to follow, including me. I also want to thank Chuck Olson of the Prosecuting Attorney's Council for playing much the same role that Mary Beth Westmoreland of the AG's office did, and having another set trained of eyes on these statutes to make sure that we didn't miss anything, or we attempted not to miss anything. And finally, Mr. Speaker, and I'll yield for questions in just a moment, I want to thank one other person, and that's the person whose vision led to this bill becoming presented to you today, this substitute becoming presented to you today, and that's Governor Nathan Deal. I sat over there next to Representative Green during Governor Deal's inaugural address when we were all snowed in, if you recall, about a little more than a year ago. And where I sit right there, I almost look right through the teleprompter, you know, to the whoever is speaking back there, and of course it was Governor Deal. And I heard, I believe I heard in his, maybe within the first paragraph of his first inaugural address, him speak about drug courts, rehabilitation, alternative sentencing, using our tax dollars more in a wiser fashion, so that we're incarcerating those people who truly need to be inside the wire, as Commissioner Owens would say. And I thought to myself, I'm sitting here looking at an inaugural address of a new governor, and he's talking about judicial reform, criminal justice reform, in his first paragraph of his inaugural. And I thought, looking at him, I thought, there must be something wrong with the teleprompter. It couldn't possibly be that soon in his address. And then I realized it was very much on purpose. And then as the year has gone on, I have seen the seriousness and the engagement and the passion and the commitment that this governor has made to this issue. Because we've come to the point in our criminal jurisprudence where we have to do things smarter. It's not necessarily just for the sake of tax dollars. It's for the sake of public safety. When we go ahead and dedicate prison beds to those people who need to be there, that enhances public safety. When we go ahead and have alternative sentencing mechanisms, including drug courts, including community-based probation, including other community-based alternatives, we give that individual a chance, not a guarantee, a chance to be a productive member of our society. At a certain point, it's up to them. But in our society, we do better to promote that kind of rehabilitation where that rehabilitation is possible. And where it's not possible and there is a public safety threat, that person belongs inside the wire. And this bill provides judges with sentencing ranges that are very healthy, that will give them the tools that they need to incarcerate those for a very long time who need to be incarcerated for a very long time. And for those who would do better in, let's say, a drug court setting, gives them the opportunity to do that according to their judicial discretion. And that's why we have judges. So with that, Mr. Speaker, I'll go ahead and yield for questions. I'll be happy to answer that I can. If I can't, if it's more of a technical question that I may not be able to answer right away, I won't hesitate to punt to the Attorney General's office once I go ahead and yield the well.
You have questions? Chair recognizes Representative Kidd to your left for a question.
Mr. Chairman, yield. Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Two or three questions, if I may.
Sure.
And these questions really come from two sheriffs in my two counties, the two mayors from my two counties, and some county commissioners from my two counties. Was there any sheriff or police officer, per se, on this council?
I was not a member of the council, so I don't know all the members of the council. I know that there's a wide variety of individuals from the system, but I can't stand here and say that I know exactly that there was a member of law enforcement on the council.
To best my recollection, looking over those, there was one DA. Another question, if I may, Mr. Chairman.
Sure.
In your opinion, when we change the figures from $500 to $1,500, for different types of theft, be it some types of burglary or bad checks or whatever. Is that going to require our local counties to hire more people because these people will now be in our state, in our county courts rather than our state courts because it's a misdemeanor and not a felony?
I think the short answer is we don't know for sure because we haven't gone ahead and we don't know yet, but I think intuitively what will end up happening over time is that you will see more of these, what I'll call petty thefts, being prosecuted in state court than you will in superior court as they are now. So I think over the course of time, you will see a slow increase in court traffic in particular state courts. I do think that'll occur. I think it'll occur slowly over time, though.
Yeah, again, one or two more, if I may, Mr. Chairman.
Of course.
The vast majority of the crimes, are they under $1,500 or over $1,500?
I don't have that exact figure. I do know that $1,500 represents something of an average or a median of where other states in our region are. In terms of the exact number of, if you're asking me, the average theft is what amount? I think that's going to vary in terms of our theft statutes. Is it shoplifting? Is it theft by taking? Is it theft by deception? Is it theft by conversion? Which one, you know, is it? That I don't think, I'm not sure that's available at all. I don't have that figure.
Did I hear you say, Mr. Chairman, that if someone goes in and has retail theft of over $500, or let's say $600, that would be prosecuted as a felony.
Yes, sir.
But if you have a bad check writing ring of thefts, and they can write $1,450 bad checks all day long, that would be a misdemeanor.
It depends on the level of the check, and I think there's a provision I'd have to check about how many checks you would write in a certain period of time in an aggregate that could rise to a certain threshold and therefore be a felony.
Last question, I'll just reword it possibly, that I don't think you basically said that, in your opinion, that this would cause our sheriffs and local counties to have to hire additional people, possibly to enforce the aspects of this now, because it'll be in the county courts and filling up the county jails, or and just another shift from state dollars to county dollars.
Well, I don't think I'd quite put it that way. It is important to remember that these levels have been in effect since 1983. That is 30 years. So to say, you know, I think there's, I would say nothing wrong with updating those statutes. I will say that I agree that over time there will be an increase in state court. By the same token, if there is an increase in state court, the increase in charges in state court, there's also going to be an increase of fines in state courts and therefore within the county level. Now, I can't stand here and tell you that increased fines will absolutely positively offset the increase of increased jail costs. I can't do that, honestly. I do know that there will be more fines generated, though, on the county level.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And the way this bill is, if we wanted to try to amend some of that language, replacing it back to a felony for somebody who wrote a bad check for $1,400, we can't do that. And so, therefore, myself and probably others have got to hold our nose and vote for this.
Well, Representative Kidd, let me offer you this. Criminal justice reform is not a one-time shot. We will be here, if we're serious about criminal justice reform, and I think we are, and I know this governor is, I think anytime you take on a big issue, you're going to be back year to year. My sense is there's going to be another chapter of criminal justice reform next year, looking at other areas of our court system and our laws. If we see over the course of 2 or 3 years a trend that has a negative effect on our locals, then we do well to come back and address that directly. So it's not a one-time shot. It's not, we're doing this and you'll just have to deal with it no matter what. If there are, you know, there are always consequences to actions. They could be positive, they could be negative. We're not going to stick our heads in the sand in the future. Let's see how the trend plays out over the next 2-3 years, and then we'll address it accordingly.
Do you yield for further questions? Chair recognizes Chairman Talton to your left for a question.
Would you yield?
Yes, sir.
Isn't it true that I, as a law enforcement officer of 41 years, served on this council, and I endorse this piece of legislation 100%?
Thank you. And of course, I always think of Chairman Talton in his chairman capacity and fail to remember his decades of service as a sheriff from his area of the state. So that goes to Representative Kidd's question earlier, and I thank the gentleman for his support.
Chair recognizes Representative Hatfield to your right for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I had a couple of questions, Mr. Chairman.
Sure.
Will you yield?
Sure.
Okay. Looking at page 18, line 613, dealing with the offense of forgery in the fourth degree, that will be a new crime, as I understand, which is predicated upon not only the fraudulent making of the check, but also the delivering of the check, and it being less than $1,500. And it's my understanding that that provision will be a misdemeanor offense. Is that correct?
Yes.
And that would be, my question is, that would be a change from current law insofar as any forged check or other instrument which is delivered under current law, regardless of the amount, constitutes a forgery in the first degree right now.
If the gentleman so states.
I'm just trying to clarify. Is that your understanding, Mr. Chair?
Yeah, I mean, with all the different degrees of the different crimes, I'm sure the gentleman is correct. I don't recall it off the top of my head, but I do know that when talking about prison admissions, again, for 2010, and looking at one of those nonviolent offenses that is driving our prison population and occupying beds that are better suited for a violent offender, I do recall forgery being in there. And so therefore, in trying to make a, for lack of a better term, graduated approach to that crime, okay, that was the approach that was taken.
Okay. Well, I asked that question, if you'll further yield.
Certainly.
Because my understanding has been that under existing law, that we looked at a felony grade offense a forgery being based primarily on the fact that the person delivers or utters the writing, in other words, passes the writing somewhere. And so this is somewhat of a departure from that current sort of mindset. Is that correct?
It is, and of course it is a below a certain threshold. It's below a certain threshold of that 1500, and in trying to have some consistency in our theft crime law and our theft crime laws, we wanted to go ahead and maintain some uniformity to the extent that we could.
Okay. If you'll further yield, I got a couple of other quick questions. Looking on page 11 at line 352 through 372, dealing with burglary.
Right.
This bill apparently is going to create the offenses of burglary in the first degree, second degree, and third degree. And I wanted to get an understanding of exactly what differentiates the burglary in the third degree. Is that it doesn't have any language about for use as a dwelling of another. Is that the distinguishing
factor? Yes, sir, it is. That's correct.
Okay. And the last question is on line, on page 12, lines 396 through 398. And I understand this is in existing law, but it is now being applied specifically to burglary in the first degree. But is the intent of that provision that a burglary in first degree, which carries, I think now it's going to be 5 to 30 years.
That's right.
Does that mean that they would have to, that a conviction for that would result in a defendant being sentenced to prison no less than 5 years?
Correct. That would entail, and that's where you have a dwelling, what I'll call a dwelling burglary, which is essentially a second degree burglary,
right,
with the aggravating circumstance of while the person's in possession of a weapon or explosive causes physical harm. You know, it's
right,
one of the aggravating circumstances. And that was the difference, the delineation between a second degree and a first degree. That is, you know, the policy proposal in that for that provision is if you have a situation where it is burglary in the first degree and those aggravating circumstances occur, that should not be probatable. Whereas if it is a second degree burglary or a third degree burglary, that is, I'll say, eligible for, that can be, a portion of that sentence can be probated.
Right. And of course, with burglary in the first degree, the way it's defined, that's a very serious offense. But I just wanted to make sure that I understand correctly that there's no, based on the inclusion of that provision, line 396, there is no possibility of a split sentence in that situation. You can't get like a 20 serve 10 or something.
No,
you'd have to get straight prison.
It's a five to 30. And of course the judge, again, going back to judicial discretion, there'll be a situation where the, you know, that's a five,
right,
is appropriate. There may be a situation where there should be an upward departure, have the judge make that call. But I think the policy proposal on that is that not only is it a dwelling, someone's home, but it is a home and there was a weapon involved and someone was hurt or any other aggravating circumstance as per the paragraph.
Right. All I'm trying to establish, though, is that the sentence will have to be an entirely sentence to be served in prison.
Correct.
There's no probatable portion of the
That is correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Do you further yield?
I think I should, Mr. Speaker, yes.
Chair recognizes Representative Welch to your left for a question.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, do you yield?
Yes, sir.
Is it not true that legislative counsel, including Ms. Jill Travis, did an exceptional job on crafting and helping and assisting with this bill and that I fully support this bill?
Thank you so much for your comment. And I mentioned Ms. Travis earlier, and I'm glad you're doing that now, that we don't fully appreciate. I've been here for several years now, and I try my best to go ahead and fully appreciate the job that they do. And it's not, there's so much that goes on when we're not here in order to make the wheels turn that I'm personally grateful. I know others who are involved are grateful as well. And we couldn't have this bill without Ms. Travis, certainly.
You have no further questions.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, I commend this bill to you. I thank you for your time and your patience. And I ask for your favorable consideration of House Bill 1176.
Chair recognizes the Chairman of the State Institutions and Property Committee, Chairman Neal, to speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, this is a great day. I am so excited to be able to stand before you and speak to House Bill 1176. Last year, we had the opportunity to be joined by the Speaker, Lieutenant Governor, Chief Justice, the Governor, the Attorney General, for a press conference announcing the introduction of House Bill 265 to create the Criminal Justice Reform Council. The council did an incredible job, and this is an important thing that I think everybody needs to realize. They did an incredible job looking at the data in Georgia, looking at the prison population drivers in Georgia, and put together a report based upon what's happening in the state of Georgia to drive our prison population. Over the last 20 years, we've seen our prison population basically double. We've seen our corrections spending more than double. We're on an unsustainable path if we didn't do something with criminal justice reform. As a matter of fact, if we did nothing, we would have about $264 million in additional correction spending over the next 5 years just to keep up with the growth of nearly 5,000 beds. They addressed those drivers. Chairman Golic did a great job spelling out for us what's in this package to address those drivers, and I appreciate the work that Chairman Golic has done and the Joint Committee. Let me echo just a couple of other things that he said. This was an effort where with the work groups and the committee, subcommittees that were working with the special counsel, stakeholders from all over the state, different areas were involved in those work groups putting together the report. And then we have had, I can't tell you how many meetings with stakeholders pulling this together and massaging it and coming to where we are today. And I think what we have today is an incredible piece of legislation. And I'll also echo Jill Travis, what an unbelievable job she's done. And I don't think any of us understand how many hours that she's put in on this. I want to talk to you about a couple of aspects of the bill. And I want to start with addressing Representative Kidd's questions, because I think these are very important questions that have come up throughout the process as well. There are a number of things that we have proposed with House Bill 1176 that will have a direct impact on counties. The raising of the thresholds will have an impact in that there'll be more people coming in with misdemeanors into state court. But let me share with you some ways that we're going to be able to address that with House Bill 1176. One of the things that the sheriffs have been wanting for a long time. As a matter of fact, before I got here, they were trying to get electronic transfers of sentencing packages. And right now, when someone's sentenced, that sentencing package is mailed. It takes a while to get there, and then it may sit on a desk for a little while. And those counties still have those offenders in their jail as their responsibility until that sentencing package is finally acknowledged. And this electronic transfer piece is a piece that's going to mean that those offenders are very quickly going to become state detainees and not county detainees. That is one of the areas where we're going to move that backlog of the jails, substantial movement by getting those electronic transfers. There are a couple of other things that are going to also ease the backlog in the jails as well. Right now, the probation detention centers are being used in many times sentences up to a year or maybe two in probation detention centers, and that's not what probation detention centers were intended to be all about, what they were created for. One of the things that this legislation does is it reduces the length of time that a offender can be sentenced to a probation detention center to 180 days. By moving them through those probation detention centers, by not having those offenders in county jails waiting on the opportunity to get to the probation detention center, that will also ease the backlog. We also realize that We don't have enough residential substance abuse treatment beds in our state prisons. In this budget, the governor has proposed, and we have agreed, we're going to move forward opening up 600 new residential substance abuse treatment beds, RSAT beds. Those 600 RSAT beds represent 600 offenders that right now are in county jails waiting for a bed to get into RSAT. So that will ease the backlog in county jails as well. We're also working with day reporting centers to help ease that backlog in the county jails. And another thing that we've done in Title 42 is we have included graduated sanctions for probationers. What graduated sanctions means is instead of every time there's a minor violation of probation and the probation officer has to bring someone back before the judge and they end up going to the county jail for a few days to a few weeks to a few months, many of those minor violations will be able to be addressed by the probation officer without having to go back to a judge. It may be that that the probation officer will recommend substance abuse treatment, or maybe even a treatment program, or maybe some curfew. But there are plenty of options. And one of the things that's very important when you're talking about drug addicts, one of the things that's very important, and everywhere you look, every study you look at, anytime you look at evidence-based practices, one of the most important things is that there's sure and swift sanctions to violations. They don't get that when they're having to go back through the court process and get back to the judge. And so many times, probation officers don't even do anything about those minor violations. They wait until there's a major violation, and then that offender goes back before the judge and back into the jail. By doing graduated sanctions, they can provide swift and definite sanctions to those minor violations that will keep those offenders on track and thereby reduce the number of probationers that are going back into the jails. Now, if there's a probation violation that necessitates incarceration, they'll have to go back before the judge. The probation officer won't be able to do that. The judge will be the only one that'll have the freedom and the opportunity, the ability to take away their freedom and their liberty. But all of those things will create a tremendous ease to the backlog in the county jails. So that's one way we're going to be able to help the counties. There are a couple other things that are going to help the counties as well. One of the things that we're doing with House Bill 1176 is we're expanding the collection of DATE funds. Those are fines that are applied to certain charges, 50% of the fine. Those are specific, dedicated funds that stay within the local county and can only be used for select purposes. Those fines will be added to additional charges, which will mean additional DATE fund money coming into those local counties. And we're also increasing to where, or opening up the approved expenditures for those DATE funds so that counties that have accountability courts, whether it's drug court or mental health court or DUI court, those counties with accountability courts will be able to utilize those funds to assist with their accountability courts as well. So all of those things will help to offset. And I agree with Chairman Golick. We don't know exactly what the impact is going to be. But when we look at all of those things, they're going to be offsetting the county demand and the county load. I think we've got a fair and a balanced approach to this. And I can tell you this, based on conversations with the administration, based on conversations with the people involved, if we see that it's beginning to create somewhat of a problem within those counties, I can assure you we're going to look at it again. That's a commitment you have from us. We're not one and done here and hope that it works out. And if it doesn't, too bad. I can assure you that's not our approach to this. Those are important pieces of what we're doing in Title 42 and what we're doing in order to help ease the situation within the counties, the potential situation within the counties. And let me tell you something else that happens when we do some of this improved supervision pieces. We're going to be allowing electronic monitoring. We're going to be allowing some evidence-based practices and supervision that gets much better results. And when your supervision that you're providing within the community is a supervision that gets better results, the need to go back and have those revocations of probation becomes much smaller. We'll be able to reduce recidivism and increase public safety. And ultimately, if there's one thing that I think is important that we take away from this, is we are, with this package, we are going to be holding offenders accountable. But we're going to be holding them accountable according to their crime, according to their offense, according to the risk needs assessment that's done, and following evidence-based practices based on their assessments, based on what their needs are, so that we're treating them in the most efficient and most effective way. I can tell you this. When we treat drug offenders by sending them to prison, every study shows that we are utilizing the most expensive means possible to deal with those offenders, and we're going to get the worst results that you can get. That's not a responsible way to utilize taxpayer dollars. We've got to be better stewards than continuing to use the most expensive means possible in order to get the worst results. I don't know how many of you are in business, but you don't stay in business very long if you're utilizing expensive methods to get poor results. So we're going to be utilizing the best measures based upon the needs of those individuals. Another part of this package that I want to talk to you a little bit about is the record restriction piece, and that's part six. When we look at the criminal justice system, one of the things that really impacts, and there's a number of pieces that all go together, and we've taken into consideration all these pieces, but one of the pieces that really impacts criminal activity is the opportunity to get jobs. In the state of Georgia, one out of 13 adults in the state of Georgia, by the way, are under correctional supervision of some kind. The national average is 1 out of 31. 1 out of 31 national average, 1 out of 13 in the state of Georgia. And that's those who are under correctional supervision. There are others who have an arrest on their record, and even though they've never been convicted of any charges, that arrest is still on the record. I had someone come to me last year that I grew up going to church camp with him. He had a daughter that was just about to complete her degree as an RN. She was just a few weeks away from her time of practicum, and she was going through a divorce, a very difficult situation with her ex. He called the police and made some charges against her, and she was arrested under Family Violence Act. Just a few weeks away from practicum and a few months away from graduating as an RN. We found out pretty quickly that as long as that arrest was on her record, she could not do the practicum, she could not graduate, and she would not be able to work as an RN. She was one of the very fortunate ones that had a judge that looked at her case and said, "I'm going to help you." And he not only did all the necessary paperwork, her ex-husband signed to dismiss the charges, he did all the necessary paperwork, and he personally walked to the sheriff's department and the clerk of court and to the DA's office, did everything that he had to do. She was a fortunate one that had somebody in the system that was willing to go the extra mile so that she could do her practicum and so she could graduate. And by the way, right now she's employed as an RN and doing great. Doesn't happen that way for many of our Georgians, because they don't have somebody that's willing to go that extra mile for them. Some of them have situations on the record that can't be addressed, and others of them don't have the means with which to do it. Part six addresses that, and in part six, anyone who is arrested and not prosecuted, arrested and no pros, arrested and gets two no bills from a grand jury, their record will be restricted with GCIC. They can petition the court and have their records restricted with the clerk of court's office. Anyone who is acquitted, by a jury, their record will be restricted unless the prosecutor in 10 days shows to the judge why there's a good reason why that record shouldn't be restricted. It also addresses some youthful offenders, misdemeanor offenses that may have happened I don't know about you, but I know some folks when they were teenagers were involved in some activities that got them a misdemeanor or could have gotten them a misdemeanor. This gives them an opportunity to be able to petition to have those misdemeanors restricted if they're youthful offenders. It also addresses offenders who complete drug or accountability court programs and gives them opportunities to have certain things restricted as well. This is a good piece of legislation that that we sat down together with the DAs and the criminal defense folks, and we sat down for probably, we actually got together more than once, but we finally sat down the last time for about 2 or 3 hours, and we worked through this process until we got consensus. And let me tell you something, it was quite an accomplishment when we got consensus from that group. This is a great piece of legislation. This will have a positive impact on the state of Georgia. It will improve public safety. It will reduce recidivism. It will help us to be a better steward of taxpayer dollars. It will save us money in correction spending, which can be reinvested into the community. We've already seen that commitment in the budget with $1.4 million added for parole officers, $10 million added for the expansion of accountability courts. And you're going to see, as we move forward over the next few years, you're going to see a renewed commitment, a continued commitment to invest into the community services needed, the community supervision needed, those things that are needed where we can effectively manage our offender population in the most effective and proven way to do so. Great piece of legislation. I'm excited about it. I would ask your support. I would love to see, with this piece of legislation, I'd love to see all Y's on the board. Wouldn't that be great? As much work as went into this. Mr. Speaker, I will yield for questions.
You have a number. Let's see. Chair recognizes Representative Morgan to your left for a question.
Does the chairman yield?
Yes, I do.
Isn't it true, Mr. Chairman, that I'm very grateful for your passion and the leadership that you and others have shown to get us to this point?
Thank you.
I just have a couple of questions for clarification. You talked about Part 6. And first of all, I wanted to clarify that for those individuals who fit into these categories, that this is, if passed, this would be retroactive, correct?
There is a retroactive piece. The retroactive is a little bit different, and I'm going to make sure that I don't get out of line on this one. The retroactive is a little bit different. With the retroactive, an offender will still need to petition the prosecuting attorney, and then if they're not satisfied with that, we'll have an opportunity to go to the Superior Court judge. Is that correct?
Okay, and so that's part of what I wanted to know. So my other question is, I have a constituent who is, I think would fall into this category, and when he is going to apply for jobs, the arrest shows up.
Mm-hmm.
And so in his situation, if this passes, am I correct that, as you said, first he would have to go to the prosecuting attorney mm-hmm. to see if that could be sealed, I guess? Is
correct.
That what you would call
We're
it?
We're talking about restricted, and that's another
restricted.
Good point, not expunged. If you're able to get an expungement under current law, which is very difficult, that expungement means fingerprint cards, mugshots, everything completely destroyed. With this record restriction, it's restricted to the public. Law enforcement still has opportunity to see it. The judicial system can still see it, but the public can't.
And so if someone is applying for a job, this would not come up?
It'll not come up on a criminal background check. That's
okay.
Correct.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
You yield for further questions?
I do.
Chair recognizes Representative Abdul Salam to your right for a question.
Thank you, sir. Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, ma'am.
Representative Neal, I know that we had a lot of conversations, and I do appreciate you for coming to our community to visit one of the reentry facilities. Does this legislation have a provision in it that will help to make it easier for offenders to get employment? Because we know no matter what their demons are, they're less likely to reoffend if they can have some gainful employment.
Not directly. There are some things that will come out of this indirectly with some of the community services that are provided. If it's someone that qualifies for the record restriction, then obviously it will benefit them if they can get the record restricted. If they don't qualify for a record restriction, if they are under parole or probation supervision, there could very well be some opportunities that come out of this, although they're not expressed here. But could very well be some opportunities to come out of this where they'll be able to get some some type of supportive employment or some type of assistance, whether it's through just direction or direct assistance, that might be a thing that could come out of it, but it's not specifically expressly implied in the legislation.
Further question.
Yes.
One of the things that we do at Second Chance Staffing, which is a nonprofit for people coming out of prison, is that we also try to link and guide them with programs and treatment. But I didn't really hear much about anything being added for treatment. Is that something that we have to look forward to down the road, or is there something that maybe I just missed?
I think you'll see that. It's not, again, that's not spelled out specifically within this bill, but where you'll see that is especially in the communities where the accountability courts are, you're going to of necessity see a ramping up of those community-based services in those areas. As probation and parole begin to focus more on guiding these offenders into assimilating within the community, you may very well see that as well, but it is not specifically called for in the legislation.
And you guys will be working on this further in the year that the commission doesn't disband or anything.
I can assure you I will be.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Do you continue to yield?
Sure.
Chair recognizes Representative Battles to your right for a question.
Would my friend yield?
Absolutely.
Is it not true that I support this bill? I do have a question, and the question is simply this: what percentage of those that presently are incarcerated that would be subject to this type of sentence? What percentage of those that are incarcerated right now that we look to be outside the prison walls?
This will not directly impact those who are already incarcerated.
I understand that, but when we talk about a savings, mm-hmm. what are we looking at as in the future?
Okay.
As to the savings
within the next 5 years, this legislation should save us somewhere in the neighborhood of 4,500 to 5,000 beds.
And that's based on the present number of.
That's based on if we don't do anything. If we don't pass any kind of reform and we just continue down the path we're on for the next 5 years,
yes.
Compared to if we do this, the savings by doing this will be in the neighborhood of 4,500 to 5,000 beds.
And this one other question.
Okay.
Is it not true that this savings can be redirected now into rehabilitation?
Absolutely,
and put it to greater benefit for those that are in the past have been incarcerated.
Where you get more bang for the buck, for example, we have a 30-some percent recidivism rate now for those who come out of the prison system. The Day Reporting Center in Rome, I saw the recidivism rate for there, and I'm going to go on memory, and I may miss this by just a little bit, but it's not much. I think the recidivism rate out of that DRC in Rome is about 7%. When you're able to have that kind of an impact on your recidivism rate, you have a huge impact on future correction spending, which gives you those funds that you need to be able to take care of your counties and be able to take care of your community services and your correction community corrections.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Bill.
Mr. Speaker, I'm going to yield the well and simply ask before I do that you join me in passing a piece of legislation that that is a very substantial piece of legislation that that has been worked on hard by many, many people from every from just about every area that you can imagine. And I just ask you today to join me in passing this piece of legislation. And I would, as I said earlier, would love to see all wise up there. Thank you all. I yield the floor.
Gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 1176 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? All members. If so, the clerk. If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the passage of House Bill 1176, the ayes are 164, the nays are 1. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. The chair would like to announce that Senate Bill 492 will be postponed to the next legislative day. Chair would like to announce that Senate Bill 362 will be postponed to the next legislative day. For what purpose does Chairman Golic rise?
Make a motion, Mr. Speaker.
State your motion.
Mr. Speaker, I would move that House Bill 1176 be transmitted immediately to the Senate.
On the gentleman's motion that House Bill 1176 be immediately transmitted to the Georgia State Senate. Is there objection? The chair hears none. It is so ordered. It is on its way. Clerk will read the caption to Senate Bill 351. Senate Bill 351.
Senate Bill 351 by Senator Crosby of the 13th, bill being entitled Amendment Title 36 relating to municipal courts so as to acquire the same training for all judges of courts exercising municipal court jurisdiction. Bill having been before the House Committee on Judiciary, committee recommends the bill to pass by committee substitute and be read for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Powell to present the bill. Just a minute, Mr. Chairman. We still have bills on the rules calendar. This House will be at order. The House will be at order. Chair recognizes Chairman Powell to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is Senate Bill 351. It really is a simple bill. Currently, municipal court judges are required to undergo training. There are a lot of municipal courts in the state, but they're called various things. Some of them are called recorder's courts, some of them are called city courts, some of them are called police courts. But no matter what the name, they should be required to undergo the same degree of training. All this does is specifies that no matter what the name, if they exercise municipal court powers, they're required to undergo the same training. Mr. Speaker, if there are no questions, I will yield the well.
You have no questions. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of Senate Bill 351 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines on the passage of Senate Bill 351. The ayes are 158, the nays are zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed.
Clerk will read the caption of Senate Bill 489.
Senate Bill 489 by Senator Mullis, the 53rd, a bill being entitled Act Title 31 relating to emergency medical services so as to require the Georgia Trauma Care Network Commission to report annually to the House and Senate Committees on Health and Human Services, documenting certain outcomes and verifying certain expenditures of funds. Bill had been for the House Committee on Health and Human Services. That committee recommends this bill to pass. Bill is being read today for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Reinders to present the bill.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. This is a great transparency bill. It simply says that the Trauma Commission of Georgia will report to the Health and Human Services Committee in both the House and in the Senate what they're doing with their funds and what their plans are as they move the Trauma Commission forward. And if there's no questions, Ms. Speaker, I yield the well.
The gentleman has yielded the well. There are no questions. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All in favor of the passage of the bill will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas were 162, the nays were zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to Senate Bill 412.
Senate Bill 412 by Senator Miller of the 40th, a bill of entitled Act, Amend Code Section 20-252.1 relating to composition, election of county boards of education in counties which there is no homestead exemption, sales and use tax, and a county sales and use tax for educational purposes and terms of service so as to delay the effective date of that code section, January 1, 2015. Bill having been for the House Committee on Education, the committee recommends that this bill do pass. Bill's being read for the third time.
Chair recognizes Representative Taylor of the 79th to present the bill.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. What I bring to you is HB 412, which is a housekeeping bill relating only to the section of SB 79 from last year that refers to DeKalb County. Inadvertently, what happened with that was it reduced the number of school board members from 9 to 7, but it did not take into account the effective date would cut off two of the at-large members in the mid-term terms. All this does is extend the implementation date until the end of the term. And I'll be glad to take any questions. This is one bill that I will say, in a rare moment of unity, with the entire DeKalb delegation is on board with this one. And I'll take any questions.
There are no questions. Gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All in favor of the passage of the bill will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas were 158, the nays were zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to Senate Bill 352.
Senate Bill 352 by Senator Crosby of the 13th, Bill of Entitled Act, Amendment Title 15 relating to prosecuting attorneys, provide for prosecuting attorneys in probate courts, municipal courts, courts exercising municipal court jurisdiction, provide for the process of that employment. Bill having been for the House Committee on Judiciary and on Civil, committee recommends that the bill passed by committee substitute be read third time.
Chair recognizes Representative Welch to present the bill.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I present to you Judge Crosby's bill, Senate Bill 352. This creates a municipal prosecutorial office. It also defines under Section 1 some expanded jurisdiction for DAs and solicitors when it comes to enforcing civil penalties under our code. Section 3 is creates a succession plan for solicitor generals. And Section 4 is the article that creates the municipal prosecutor's office. And under Section 5 expands the jurisdiction of municipal courts to prosecute transactions in drug-related objects. If there are any questions, Madam Speaker, I'll be happy to take those. There's also an amendment, I should note, that's been in your book since yesterday. The amendment addresses some issues that GMA had with this bill. With the amendment, Georgia Municipal Association supports Senate Bill 352. The Prosecuting Attorneys Council supports Senate Bill 352. Municipal court judges also support this bill. And so I ask for your favorable support on the bill today, if you can indulge me in such. I'll accept the questions.
You have a question. The chair recognizes Representative Weldon for a question.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. We yield.
Yes, sir.
Has the Georgia Association of Criminal Defense Lawyers endorsed this bill?
I'm not aware that they have or have not.
You're not aware of their position on this bill?
No, sir, I am not.
Thank you.
There are no more questions.
Thank you, then I yield the well.
Gentlemen, I yield to the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Clerk will read the amendment.
Representative Welch, 110th, offers the following amendment. Amendment of the House Committee on Judiciary and Non-Civil Substitutes, Senate Bill 352. This amendment is printed in your calendar books, AM 21-38-16.
Is there any objection to adopting the amendment? Chair hears none. The amendment is adopted. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute as amended? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted as amended. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All in favor of the passage of the bill will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas were 154, the nays were zero. The bill, having received the constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption as Senate Bill 407.
Senate Bill 407 by Senator Unterman of the 45th, Bill of Entitled Act, Amendment Title 31 relating to health, so as to repeal the creation of the Health Strategist Council, Clinical Laboratory, Blood Bank, and Tissue Bank Committee to correct a cross-reference. Bill has been before the House Committee on Health and Human Services. Committee recommends this bill do pass. Bill's being read for the third.
Chair recognizes Representative Cook to present the bill.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Members of the House, today I bring for you, for your consideration, Senate Bill 407. This bill is pretty straightforward. Basically, all it's a Department of Community Health bill. What it does is it removes some red tape and allows the department to function a little more effectively. In 2008, there was legislation that created a council and also another commission. Since then, there has been the positions have been vacant, and there's really never been any purpose for them. At this point in time, all we're doing is, as you can see in the bill, is striking those and removing that, and therefore the Department of Community Health will be able to function more efficiently. So if there's no questions, Madam Chair, I'll yield the well.
You do have a question.
Okay.
Chair recognizes Representative Roberts of the 154th for a question.
Does the gentleman yield?
I do.
Is it not true that when you have a tractor and you take the diesel cap off and leave it off while you bush hog your whole pasture, that it can mess up your tractor? Is that not true?
That is true.
Is it further not true that you were one that has done that?
A 68 horsepower Kubota tractor will not run on oak leaves. I know that to be true.
Thank you.
There are no more questions.
I yield the well. I appreciate your favorable consideration.
Gentlemen, has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? Chair hears none. The previous question is is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All in favor of the passage of the bill will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas were 156, the nays were zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to Senate Bill 473.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Quite an honor to have the first and the last bill today. Senate Bill 473 does one thing. It allows those who have been awarded the Purple Heart citation to be able to have the Purple Heart tag while they're still on active duty. I yield the will.
Wait, no, gentlemen will suspend. Clerk will read the caption to Senate Bill 473.
Senate Bill 473 by Senator Harper's 15th bill being titled Act, Section 402084 relating to the issuance of license plates to veterans awarded Purple Hearts. Bill had been before the House Committee on Motor Vehicles. Committee recommends the bill do pass. Be ready for the third time.
The chair will now recognize the chairman of insurance to present the bill.
Madam Speaker, ditto. Now, once again, all this does is allow someone who's been awarded the Purple Heart citation to have a Purple Heart tag while they're still on active duty.
I yield the will.
The gentleman has questions, and I believe he has yielded the will. For what? You wave. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All in favor of the passage of the bill will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas were 154, the nays were zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Chair recognizes Representative Jacobs for a motion.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I move that the House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 110.
Clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 110 by Representative Jacobs, the 80th, bill being titled Act, Amendment Title 44, relating to generally to mortgages, conveyances to secure debt, liens provided vacant property registry, definition provided required elements for a form of the registration. The House passed version of House Bill 110 has been printed, placed on your desk. It's upper right-hand corner, HB 110/CSFA. The Senate substitute or the Senate passed version of House Bill 110 is also printed on your desk, upper right-hand corner, HB 110/SCSFA/1.
Representative Jacobs moves that the House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 110. The chair recognizes Representative Jacobs to explain the Senate substitute.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, this was the vacant and foreclosed property registry bill that was passed by the House last year. It was considered by the Senate on day 31. As you'll recall, we have local governments setting up these registries today already around the state. They are doing it on different terms, using different standards, and there is a need to bring everyone onto the same page using the same standards whenever they decide, if they decide to set up these registries. The differences between the House and the Senate bills are that the Senate version of the House version of the bill had blanket preemption for any kind of real property registry. We are now only preempting registries with regard to vacant property or unoccupied property or foreclosed property. But again, these registries are being set up around the state already. They are being done on different terms, and it is causing a logistical nightmare. The largest jurisdiction to adopt one of these between the last legislative session and the current legislative session was Gwinnett County. We have all of the stakeholders on board with this bill, including with the Senate version of the bill, including the bankers, the realtors, GMA, and ACCG. Therefore, I would ask for the House's favorable consideration of the bill and that the House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 110. Madam Speaker, I will yield for a couple of questions.
There is a question. The Chair recognizes Representative Williams of the 89th.
With that, Madam Speaker, I will yield the well.
The gentleman has yielded the well. On the gentleman's motion that the House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 110, all those in favor will vote yes, all those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the gentleman's motion. The yeas were 145, the nays were 12. The House has agreed to the Senate substitute to House Bill 110. There'll be page photos upon adjournment. If you have announcements, please come to the front. We'll be taking those in just a moment. We have two birthdays to recognize. The first, we have a birthday today. We all want to join together and tell Pat Gardner, happy birthday. We have another birthday before we meet again on Monday. Jimmy Pruitt will be having a birthday on Saturday.
The only announcements I have are...
The Chair recognizes Representative Hanner.
As a matter of speaker, I'd like to make a motion.
If you can wait just a moment, we're going to take a few announcements and then I'll recognize you. Yes, sir. Chair recognizes Chairman Golick for an announcement.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Judiciary Non-Civil will meet upon adjournment in room 132 to consider two Senate bills. Judiciary Non-Civil upon adjournment. Room 132. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Chairman Coleman for an announcement.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Members of the House, please listen very carefully. Education Committee members, immediately after adjournment, 341, down there where they have the rules meetings, we will have an education meeting. 341, immediately after adjournment. All Education Committee members. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Chairman England for a motion or for an announcement.
Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Just a quick note, you'll be getting a notice if you're a member of the Appropriations Committee. We will be having a full committee meeting Monday morning, 8 a.m., room 341, to hear Senate Resolution 20.
Chair recognizes Chairman Morris for an announcement.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. The House Banking Committee will meet immediately upon adjournment. We'll be meeting in CLOB 406. Banks and Banking, immediately upon adjournment, we'll be taking up Senate Bill 448. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Representative Hanner for a motion.
Madam Chairman, I'd like to move that this House do now adjourn until Monday morning, that is at 10 o'clock, Monday morning, March the 25th.
You're right. On the motion of Representative Hanner that this House stand adjourned until Monday, 10 a.m., March 26th, all those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed will say no.
No.
The ayes clearly have it, and we're adjourned until Monday, March 26th.